Hey MMT followers, Christina Fuges with MoldMaking Technology and another quick MMT chat. Today my guest is Laurie Harbour with Harbour Results, and I can't imagine anybody out there, at least in my circles, that doesn't know who you are already, but just in case, why don't we start off by giving a little background on yourself and Harbour Results, and then we'll kind of get into our conversation.
Okay. Well, thank you for having me. Harbour Results is a small manufacturing consulting firm. We do a lot of work in the mold making business and in the molding business, as well as stamping and die making. So we're doing process improvement and, most importantly, collecting a lot of benchmarking data and particularly a lot of market intelligence, especially now, but all the time on a regular basis, but now more than ever.
Because what you do is perfect for times like this, right? So you guys are in, probably not now, but you're typically right in a lot of jobs, right? In and out. So, and I know you talk a lot about top performing jobs and the best practices that these shops, mold builders, molders have in place. So I think this ties great with how you need to survive and work through COVID-19. So can you talk a little bit about those practices, and hopefully we can learn if shops out there are actually applying them?
Yeah. There are a tremendous amount of top performing companies that are doing okay through this, at least in the short term right now. They had a strong cash position going into this crisis. And so some of them are running, some of them are not running. And as a result, they're holding their own right now. Others are struggling. If they went into this in a difficult financial position, then they're having more struggles than the norm.
You know, talking to a bunch of shops and understanding these are very extraordinary times, right? And everything's urgent. Human lives are at stake, which makes this very exciting for the shops that are busy. But they are, those shops that are in medical and packaging, right? They're learning what they're truly capable of. I mean, even though these jobs are getting put at the front of the line and it's like all hands on deck, it's record speeds for some of these jobs, and understanding the molds might not be as complex as what they typically build. But how do you recommend that these shops take a step back and really look at what they're doing and say, wow, we can do this now. You know, where can we get more efficient? Where are our inefficiencies in ordinary times?
Right, right. Yes, it's interesting. I have a lot of clients making ventilator molds today, and they made them in 2 weeks. So yeah. I joke with them like, oh, boy, it's amazing how fast we actually can make a mold when we have to. Obviously, there's a lot of factors that go into that. It's the customer. It's what the customer gives you in terms of design and engineering. And this has been an unprecedented time where the customer has given them full rein to just kind of go and cut earlier than normal, even when designs aren't done and things of that nature. But it is an opportunity for companies to step back and go, what did we do in crisis? And what can we do to improve our business going forward? There's lots of opportunities. We know that. We've been harping on it for years.
I know.
We have to learn from this, right?
I know. A lot of things when I've heard you speak and stuff you write about, you're probably almost banging your head against the wall. Like, this is the perfect opportunity to apply everything that Harbour puts out there in terms of strategies to put in place. And you kind of crossing your fingers right now that some of them have actually listened to you, you know?
Right. Right.
So I told the story of DyeTech in Grand Rapids, and they were one that they did a mold tooling, a die cast tooling for a ventilator component in 5 days. And I think they're working on even more tools as we speak. Do you have any examples? Can you share shops of mold builders or molders that you've talked to that are working on molds or tooling directly related to the virus?
Yeah, I actually have about five clients who are making ventilator molds, and in fact, we'll mold the parts. So some of the larger mold builders in the U.S. Have been, you know, they're part of General Motors, what they call Strategic Tooling Initiative Group. And so GM went to them and said, we trust you, we know you make tools, we know you mold, you know, can you do this and can you do it quickly? And they got designs on Monday of last week. And which is what, 29th or 30th of the month. And those tools are basically wrapping up this week. And they're going to start running first shots off of them next week for General Motors production to start sometime midweek next week.
Crazy. Now, is that shop one of your top performers? Like, are they following what you guys teach them?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a couple of them, and they're all in the top performer category. One of them was actually shut down because of the Michigan stay-at-home order, and the other one was able to stay open also in Michigan because they had some other government type of defense work that allowed them to be essential. But they're following all the protocols. They're managing their business very well. They went in with very strong financial positions, and they're doing everything necessary from a social distancing perspective.
Yeah, that's the key. I find it also a little inspiring how mold builders can't mold or build mold without their supply chain. So when I was telling the die tech story, I had suppliers reaching out saying, hey, we got the steel to them overnight. And hey, we got the mold components. Have you had any experience with that, with the technology suppliers and the mold builders, and mold builders are working together? And they seem to always do that. Have you seen that also, where they're stepping up their game too?
Absolutely. I mean, let's face it, we're all in this together, right? This is not like the recession of 08 and 09, where some struggled and some did well. Right. We're all in this together. So the challenging part for the suppliers of the mold building industry is, you know, if you think mold builders are at the bottom of the food chain, the suppliers are even further down the supply chain, right? So, you know, everybody's worried about cash and getting paid, but at the same time, they're following their values and saying, especially on these ventilators and masks and things, this is about helping our country. It's about getting us all out of this. So if anything, I'm hoping it's banding us together stronger so that we can be better when we come out of this.
I hope so. Have you, talking to shops, anything unique in precautions that they're taking? Or is it the typical, you know, temperature taking, separating maybe departments, not having lunch together, anything out of the ordinary?
Not anything major. I mean, definitely, I had a client who was a two-shift operation that made it a three-shift operation and spread everybody out and said, look, guys, this is temporary, but I need you to be 20 feet apart. And so they did that. They're red taping off chairs in a lunchroom so that they can let people sit in the lunchroom, but, you know, put them in different spots. They put red tape across offices so that you knew not to walk in the office because it would have been less than 6 feet. So, you know, and then different skeleton type crews to make, you know, just to be able to manage the business. There's some, as you know, some shops in Canada and the US that have 300, 400, 500 people.
Yeah.
And so they've had to close. They've had to come down to a very skeleton crew. So it's a tough time for everybody, and people are learning. And remember, we didn't have these kind of crisis plans in place. We might have had a, what if we have a fire kind of crisis plan, but we didn't have this crisis plan in place.
That's the truth. How about leadership? How have you seen or heard leadership stepping up maybe in a different way to keep their teams together and keep morale up? Because quite frankly, depending on who you are as a person, it's just like some people might not take it, I don't want to say they'll take it seriously, but like I'm a germaphobe as it is. So how does leadership really handle, we need you here for this, you know, and just suck it up?
It's a great question. And I will tell you, I have a mixed bag of customers that have kept their plants open, and I'm talking to leaders, you know, in their homes, and their plants are running. And yeah. I've been pretty critical of that. In my opinion, the best leaders are showing up every day when they're asking their people to show up every day, and they're not sitting in their office, they're out on the shop floor. And I don't mean in front of them, they're keeping their social distance, but our team needs to know we're there just like they are. We're all in this together, and that we're protecting them. And most importantly, communication is more important than it ever has been. And if for some reason you're quarantined because you traveled somewhere, you know, we were in the middle of spring break season, right? So maybe some guys were quarantined. Video chat like we're doing. You know, everybody's got TV screens in their plant. Go on a live feed and talk to your company. And we've seen that from some shops, and it's been super helpful. I mean, they're bringing lunches in for employees so that they don't have to, you know, bring their food from home, and they can save that for home. So they're doing some unique things. This is all about leadership. That's how we're going to get through it.
I agree with that. So do you see any opportunities that mold builders in particular are missing out on today? And is there a way they can take advantage of these? Are you seeing anything like that? Because you know what's interesting? We launched a sourcing assistance program online because a few weeks ago, and this kind of hit the States, we were getting suppliers, OEMs, mold builders, and mold builders contacting us saying either, we need a tooler, you know, a tooling vendor or a molder, or the other side saying we have capacity. And it was interesting how outside of their little circles, they don't know how to find each other. And it was something that kind of dawned on us, like, wow.
Right.
So it could be missing out.
Yeah, that's one of the things that we're certainly trying to do as well. For example, I have a bunch of Canadian tool shops that have programs in the US that may be non-automotive, maybe automotive, that were getting ready to do tryouts. Well, they can't cross the border. Yeah. So they're crossing the border with the tool, and then they've contacted one of their friends in the US, mold makers, and those guys are doing the tryout for them. And they're supporting some of the engineering changes, things of that nature, so that we don't miss out on opportunities. Yes. And you know, it's calling your customers on a regular basis. I mean, I have clients who've said to me, I've talked to my customers more in the last 3 weeks than I have in the last 3 years. So, and they're finding opportunities. There was a lot of mold builders who missed out on the chance to make ventilator tools because they just weren't calling their customers and weren't connected at the time that they should have been.
So communication.
Right. Yeah.
How 100%. Do you feel, before we wrap this up, what are your feelings on reshoring or sourcing locally when this is all said and done? What do you think is going to happen?
Unfortunately, I tend to be the occasional bearer of bad news, and I'm quite concerned. We worked so hard to get the mold tariff put back in place, working with Omar and Asha Shibi from the Franklin Partners, and we got it in place again. And so we started this 25% tariff on January 1st. And I think we were starting to see some impact from that. And then, of course, China went down. So we saw sourcing go here. The problem you have right now is that the China GDP has dropped to 2%, which makes them no longer an emerging nation. And that's an industry that spent a lot of money on propping up their tool makers. Now they're back and running. We're hearing they're at 90-95%. When tool packages come out the balance of the year, these guys are going to be hungrier than ever. And I think they're going to fight for price. And the companies like a GM or a Whirlpool or a John Deere, they've all struggled now this year through profit losses by being shut down. Yeah. So to launch products, I think they're going to go after price. That's my biggest fear. Wow. I think some production will come back. Yeah. I think molding will come back. I think in the short term, we're going to see them be hungry for tooling, which means we're going to have to be just as hungry.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping long-term, as we get into 2021, that tariff's really going to have an impact.
I know. It's so crazy, the timing of that, right? All that happened, and then it was like, really? Come on.
Yeah.
So any final words or recommendations for anybody listening?
Yeah, I sort of hate to be the one to deliver tough messages, but I think for the mold-making industry, things are going to go well for a while. We're not going to feel the pain for 6 to 12 months. When everything gets back up and running and companies are at full speed is going to be lower than full speed when we went into this crisis. For example, the automotive industry was at a 17 million run rate. In the back half of this year, it's going to be at a 9 to 10 million run rate. It's going to force large companies to pick and choose what programs. GE and Whirlpool have just delayed some programs. So I think we're going to see lower quote activity in the back half of the year. So people need to take this seriously, even if they're running, even if they're collecting cash today. They need to conserve cash. They need to apply for SBA loans, get every bit of free money you can get, and don't stop selling. Call your customers, be in constant communication, and sell, 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 because the opportunities will be thinner. I'm not saying they'll be gone, but they'll be thinner. And the best are going to be the ones who are going to go after those.
Yeah.
So we got to stay focused.
Yeah. Got it. Well, thank you, Laurie, for sharing your insights. I think maybe when this is all said and done, whatever that's going to be, we can reconnect and kind of talk through this through and see what happens. All right?
Absolutely. All right. Yeah, absolutely.
And again, everybody out there, stay safe, stay healthy. And for everything mold making, visit moldmakingtechnology.com.